blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the life beyond all death, the joy beyond all sorrow, our everlasting home. Amen. The Lord is with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. God of mercy, we no longer look for Jesus among the dead, for he is alive and has become the Lord of life. Increase in our minds and hearts the risen life we share with Christ, and help us to grow as your people toward the fullness of eternal life with you. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
Please be seated.
And the house filled with smoke. And I said, "Woe is me, thee, I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips. Yet my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. Then one of the seraphs flew to me, holding a live coal that had been taken from the altar with a pair of tongs. The seraph touched my mouth with it and said, Now that this has touched your lips, your guilt has departed, and your sin is blotted out. And then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, Whom shall I send, and who will go for us? And I said, Here am I, send me. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
please rise for the gospel.
The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the third chapter. Now there was a Pharisee named Nicodemus, a leader of the Jews. He came to Jesus by night and said to him, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do apart from the presence of God." Jesus answered him, "Very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above." Nicodemus said to him, "How can anyone be born after having grown old? Can one enter a second time into the mother's womb and be born?" Jesus answered, "Very truly I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and spirit. What is born of the flesh is flesh, and what is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished that I said to you, you must be born from above. The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit." Nicodemus said to him, "How can these things be?" Jesus answered him, "Are you a teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? Very truly I tell you, we speak of what we know and testify to what we have seen, yet you do not receive our testimony. If I have told you about earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Lord.
Dear friends in Christ, grace to you and peace from God our Creator, from our Lord and Savior Jesus, and from God's Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Just this past week, I was sorting through some boxes of books, and I happened to come across one from my childhood. There, those books were pages torn and worn. Some had my scribbles on them. The pictures on the covers had started to fade over the years. And the question was, should I keep them or not? And reluctantly, I decided not to keep them. So I took the box to a bookstore where the clerk offered me $30 for 25 books. I took the money and I walked out the door. But when I got to my car, I turned around and I went back into the store. And I found the clerk and I said, "I have to have just one copy back. I needed to keep one of those books because of what they represented to me. When I read them as a child, I was transported into a world of questions and mysteries. It was a magical world of curiosity and surprise." Curiosity is a virtue. In another childhood story I continue to treasure, Tom Sawyer wondered if he could convince his friends that it was a privilege to whitewash a fence. He was successful, and his curiosity and reframing of the situation changed the perspective from a negative into a positive. Curiosity is often the first step to seeing things through new eyes. Yet curiosity always gets a bad rap. As children, we were told that curiosity killed the cat. We're sometimes suspicious in the church of curiosity and questions. Some of you may know the book and the movie The Da Vinci Code, and it raises interesting questions that would provide for endless involved discussions. Psalm 77 raises questions. "God, where is your power? Why don't you hear me when I call out to you? Why do you have such a short memory? Where's your love? Where's your compassion?" The last five chapters of Job have a list of the world's most fascinating questions. And we know that the ancient rabbis loved questions. They told wonderful stories that left you hanging at the end. No answers, just questions that made you think and perhaps allowed you to see something new. Here's one of those ancient stories from the Talmud, a collection of Jewish teachings. A group of rabbis decided to give a gift to the emperor and discussed who should present the gift. They decided to ask Nahum, the man of Gamzo, because he was used to having miracles happen to him. So they gave Nahum a bag of gifts for the emperor. On the journey, Nahum spent a night at an inn. In the middle of the night, some men from the inn stole the contents of his bag and filled it with dust. Instead, when Nahum appeared before the emperor with a bag of dust, the emperor lost his temper. He said the Jews were trying to make him look foolish, and he ordered Nahum put in jail. That night, Elijah appeared to the emperor in a dream and said, "Perhaps this dust is part of the dust of their patriarch, Abraham. Whenever he threw some of it at his enemies, it turned into swords." The emperor awoke and decided to try some of the dust against his enemies. It worked. The emperor's armies won the battle. Nahum was immediately taken to the treasury, and his bag was filled with precious jewels. Then Nahum returned home. On the way, he stayed at the same inn where he told his story. The same men who had stolen from Nahum decided to take some dust to the emperor themselves. But when their dust was tested, it did not turn into swords, and all of those men were put to death. What conclusions are we to draw from such a story? The rabbis were really not interested in answers. They use stories to make students think, to raise questions, to struggle with issues, to open eyes to new truths. Being curious is good. Nicodemus, who we meet in the gospel for today, was a curious man. He was so driven by his curiosity about Jesus that he came to him in the dead of night. Nicodemus was a learned man who was well acquainted with the teaching methods of those ancient rabbis. Jesus sees the longing in Nicodemus's heart, so he responds with compassion. He welcomes Nicodemus and all of the questions. Jesus seems to know that Nicodemus is considering leaving behind the truth he has known in order to explore something new. And like a good rabbi, Jesus invites him into this new realm of insight and then pushes him beyond his comfort zone. But Nicodemus is confused by the words of Jesus. Confusion isn't necessarily a bad thing. It's often the consequence of curiosity. Nicodemus tries to make sense of these words of Jesus about being born again. So he asks questions. Nicodemus was also a rabbi. I wonder if Nicodemus realized that Jesus was helping him see a new reality. Do you suppose that Nicodemus realized being born again means that you have a chance to grow up again? If Nicodemus had that chance, what would he do differently? Jesus is inviting him to be curious about his life and look at it with a different set of assumptions and expectations. Nicodemus did not choose to be born, but he could choose a redeemed revision of his life, seeing that God loves him with a sacrificial love that flows through his life into a life that is yet to come. This was a stunning new way to think about God. For Nicodemus, the living water of the Torah was expanding into a whole new pool of wisdom. Curiosity was opening the door to transformation. Another group of spiritual people who were curious were the ones we refer to as the Desert Fathers. They were the first Christian hermits, escaping to the deserts of Egypt as early as the 4th century. They were way ahead of their time. They sought a new way to God that was uncharted and freely chosen. They were willing to lose themselves in Christ and the mysteries of life, and they knew they had to die to the world's value system as Christ had died for them and then rise from the dead with him in the light of an entirely new wisdom and truth. Here is one of their stories. One of the elders lay dying. The brothers surrounded his bed, dressed him in a shroud, and began to weep. But the elder opened his eyes and laughed. He laughed another time, and then a third time. When the brothers saw this, they asked him, saying, "Tell us, Father, why are you laughing while we weep?" He said to them, "I laughed the first time because you fear death. I laughed the second time because you are not ready for death. And I laughed the third time because I go now from my labor to my rest." And as soon as he had said this, he closed his eyes in death. Curiosity, questions, a new reality. What did Nicodemus decide about Jesus? We don't know, but there is a hint later in the story. Nicodemus goes with Joseph of Arimathea to Jesus' tomb, and Nicodemus carries with him 100 pounds of precious ointment for his teacher's body. Do you suppose the very extravagance of his gift measures and means that he got it, that he began to understand that new reality? Do you suppose that he knew Jesus' death was for him, Nicodemus, a new life covered with the extravagance of God's love? Good question. Did he understand? I wonder, do we? Amen.
Before we sing this hymn, I want to give you a roadmap of it. It has the directions, but they're in really small print. So we sing verse 1, and then automatically go back to 2 and sing verse 2, and then the refrain. Verse 3 in the refrain, verse 4 in the refrain.
I could lift you from
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one holy Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. He was incarnate by the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Welcome to worship on Holy Trinity Sunday here at Hollywood Lutheran. We're glad that you've joined us. Would you check the back pages of your bulletin for just a moment? There are some announcements that I want to highlight for you today. First of all, please note the names of those we will, in just a moment, remember in our intercessions. Today we pray especially for Susan and Raul. They had hoped to join us, but there was another incident that meant a visit to the emergency room. Susan is now home again and is doing well, but rather tired, so they didn't make it today. We were hoping Beth would be here. She has come through her surgery very well. Her surgeon is quite pleased, but there is a risk of some secondary infection, so she has not been cleared to travel in a car yet, so she sends her greetings and hopes to join us in worship very soon. Also, Joan had her surgery in San Diego, I think on Thursday. I have not heard from her, and I don't know if anyone has. We are assuming all went well. She did tell us that she will be spending some time, up to about a month, recuperating at a friend's home in San Diego before she returns to our midst. So we remember all of them in our prayers today. Our closing hymn is a little different today, but you won't have any trouble singing it if you just follow the leadership of the organ and the choir. They're going to do something a little bit different, but we're going to just keep on going. It's the closing hymn, so sing with boldness. And then, a reminder that this is a fifth Sunday, so we will have anointing and prayers of healing in just a moment. If you would like to be part of that, you're invited to come to the altar rail for that prayer. On May 29th, 1921, the charter establishing this congregation was signed. So today we celebrate our 94th anniversary as a congregation of the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America. To do that, we're going to have some special cake. So do join us. Yeah, right after worship for refreshments and anniversary cake as we join in that celebration. Those are our announcements. Once again, welcome to Hollywood. Welcome to Christ.
Confident that the resurrection of Christ has defeated sin and death, we offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all people in need. Holy God, You raise up leaders in your church who preach salvation through the death and resurrection of Christ. Inspire us to go and tell this good news throughout the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Holy God, you prayed that your people would be one. Forgive us, Lord, and take away the pride and arrogance which divides your church. Break down the walls which separate us. Unite us with your bonds of love and accomplish your will. We pray that by the power of your Spirit, your healing would work in the body of your church and through us to bring about the purpose of your will. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Holy God, you made yourself known in all creation, in mountains and valleys, in plants and animals, and those who care for what you have made. Lead us and all your creatures to proclaim that this is the day the Lord has made. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Holy God, you desire that all people live in peace. Guide all in authority at the local, state, and national and international levels, that they show no partiality in the care and in their care and concern. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Holy God, you wipe away the tears of all who cry to you in distress. Console those who are afraid. Protect those who are persecuted. Bring healing to all who suffer in mind, body, or spirit. Especially Susan and Raul in the long battle with her cancer. Charles, Beth, Cecilia, John, Beverly, and Jim for healing. Nadine and Father Hans with trust in your mercy. Corinne, Joyce, and Mary, Ivy, and Inger for wholeness and well-being. Raul Sr., Bert, Diane, Patty, Carol, Mike, and Lynn fighting cancers. And Diana, Bobby, Mario, Edward, Bob, and Brenda for help, hopefulness and strength. Holy God, you choose us to be witnesses to your love. Bless all who worship today, and especially those visitors in our midst. Grant safety to those in our community who are traveling. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
It is now, as members of his family, our opportunity to share our intercessions and petitions and our blessings, either silently or aloud.
Dear Heavenly Father, be with those who are alone, known to us, and those known to you as well. Give them strength, give them courage. Be with those who face the loss of a loved one. Comfort them, guide them. Be with us as we seek to be of service. Help us to listen, help us to be aware. And help us to share the gift of your love and everlasting life. Lord, in mercy.
Lord, help us to worship you in spirit and in truth. For this is such type of worshipers the Father seeks. Lord, in your mercy.
Holy God, you have swallowed up death forever through the resurrection of your Son. Make us confident that we will feast at your heavenly banquet with those who have died and are now at rest. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Holy God, by the death and resurrection of your Son, you have granted new life, abundant renewal, and salvation. Hear our prayers for the sake of the one who has set us free, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. You may be seated. Those seeking anointing and healing prayer are invited to come to the rail.
the gathering of our tithes and offerings.
Let us pray. Blessed are you, O God, ruler of heaven and earth. Day by day you shower us with blessings. As you have raised us to new life in Christ, give us glad and generous hearts, ready to praise you and to respond to those in need. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Lord be with you. And also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and Merciful God. You reveal your glory as the glory of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, equal in majesty, undivided in splendor, one Lord, one God, ever to be adored in your eternal glory. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. You are indeed holy, Almighty and Merciful God. You are most holy, and great is the majesty of your glory. You so loved the world that you gave your only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish but have eternal life. We give you thanks for his coming into the world to fulfill for us your holy will and to accomplish all things for our salvation. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again.
Remembering therefore his salutary command, his life-giving passion and death, his glorious resurrection and ascension, and the promise of his coming again, we give thanks to you, O Lord God Almighty, not as we ought, but as we are able. We ask you mercifully to accept our praise and thanksgiving, and with your word and Holy Spirit to bless us, your servants, and these, your own gifts of bread and wine, so that we and all who share in the body and blood of Christ may be filled with heavenly blessing and grace, and receiving the forgiveness of sin, may be formed to live as your holy people, and be given our inheritance with all your saints. To you, O God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be all honor and glory in your holy church now and forever.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Let us lift our prayer with purity of heart. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Please be seated.
Thank you. power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world and to continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Almighty God, who raised our Lord Jesus from death, lift you up and restore you to wholeness.
Amen.
Jesus Christ, the Word of life, bless you and send you to be his witnesses.
Amen.
God, the Holy Spirit, who renews the whole earth, refresh you in the gift of baptism this day and always.